Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
In his defense, I sprung that on him at like 9:45 and said, hey, Pastor Scott.
It's all right. I know that song. Praise the Lord. I love the Lord. How about you?
Amen.
Amen. There's just a wonderful feeling in this building today, one of worship and freedom. We appreciate what the Lord is doing. Amen.
Amen.
Despite everything that's going on, there is a reason to be joyous. And I'm full of joy this morning, and I want to share that with you. So I'm going to ask you, if you would, to allow us to pray for the remainder of the service. Brother Robert, would you mind standing and ask the Lord to bless the rest of the service?
Oh, Father, praise your name. Praise the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God, you're alive. Lord, that you are the God of all gods, the King of all kings, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Father, I ask that you take this meeting, Lord, that you put your words in Scott's mouth. You give us ears to hear, a heart to receive your Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, I'd like for you to turn with me to Matthew, the 12th chapter, and we'll get there eventually. I want to talk to you just a little bit this morning about your words. Praise the Lord. Your words. The weight of words. How many know there's power in words?
Yeah.
Right? The things that you say, they make a difference. The ability to communicate with others is an effective tool.
Yes, amen.
Right? Salesmen make a lot of money by being able to communicate how good this flooded car is. And, oh, don't worry about that smell. A couple air fresheners will take care of that. Being able to communicate is it's a gift, it's a talent. Being able to speak, it holds power, it holds ability. What other form of creation has God given this great talent to? And I know that animals can communicate. Kyle was sleeping in a deer stand this week, and a deer snuck up on him and let him know that he was sleeping. And deer know how to communicate, let you know that you stink. You shouldn't be here. But we have an awesome opportunity to take advantage of the power of the word. The ability to communicate with others. God has acknowledged himself the power in words at the Tower of Babel when he said, this thing they have imagined to do in Genesis, and nothing will be withheld from them that they've imagined to do. Now, that's powerful. And that's talking about a people apart from God's plan. I think you would agree with me that humanity has taken great strides in the last 100 years. Right? If you think back to 1925 and the cars that existed, the horses that were still on the road, or even just a little bit further back in the wagons, or the opportunities that people had to travel over a mountain without the benefits of an aeroplane, right? And how that aeronautics and sending rockets into space and things along that line have progressed over the last 100 years by leaps and bounds, almost seemingly faster than any other century in history. And, you know, if you look at the first 1,500 years with no technology, and now you look at the cell phones that we carry around in our pockets, which once an entire room could not hold the vast machinery needed to get that technology out and workable. I can remember when I was in high school back in the 1900s, how that, I know. It's a good joke. You know, I think about the 1800s. People now will think about the 1900s. But I can remember my first computer class and how that it was like a grayish green screen, and the letters showed up in green. And you learned how to program letters in a pattern that would make a sign. And so you would create these programs that created letters across the screen and then spaces and dots, and you could create artwork with this computer. And I was very good at drafting. I was going to be an architect, and I was very good at drawing plans with my hand, with a pencil and an eraser and templates, and I could do lettering very nicely actually drew plans that communicated how to build a house when I was a senior in high school, and that house got built. The teacher came to me and said, "My friend wants to build a house, and I want you to draw the plans." I said, "Well, praise God." So I drew the plans, and they built the house, right? Okay, how cool is that, right? Well, I went to college for the first year, and they introduced what was called AutoCAD. And had I jumped on that train and been able to embrace the technology that was there, I could have really been something of an architect. But... The influences of my life led me astray. The communication that this world relays to us often has us making choices that we should not have made, and it leads us to areas that we never should have been in. Those areas can be very productive, but they can also be not a part of God's plan. I explained all this technology to you, and you know the Tower of Babel was a tower that was supposed to reach to heaven, right? And God confounded the languages so that they couldn't communicate with one another. Now, you can take a phone and you can speak in one language and it can translate to another to speak to someone who you can't speak their language. And with that return of being able to communicate, there is going to be great power and effectiveness in human unity, and you might want to watch out for that. And the reason I say that is because God confounded the languages for a reason. He brought to me the languages back together under the auspices of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. I don't know if you remember what happened, but they all spoke in unknown tongues, and people of every language heard what they said in their heavenly language, in their earthly language, and it was about glorifying God. Now, the technology that we now have is not necessarily about glorifying God. As a matter of fact, some of the great strides that we've made when we've collaborated together between countries has brought us nuclear power, the atomic bomb. And rather than the salvation of society, we're faced with the annihilation of society, which it's a possibility. You know, Jesus said, "I wonder when I come back, will I find faith on the earth?" So I can imagine, and you know, oh man. Nothing shall be restrained that they imagine to do. Imagine we can fly. Imagine we can break gravity's pull. Imagine that we can travel to Mars or colonize the moon. I can imagine that being very possible. I can imagine technology that would allow us to grow things in space bubbles and some of these things that we are now imagining to do, the creative power of those words relayed to actuality is powerful. To harness a solid rocket booster that breaks the grip of Earth's atmosphere, that's powerful, right? I mean, and that's human intellect. Of course, you could say it's God-given human intellect, but I'll tell you something else. There's power in the word. Mm. Now, listen, I can't even imagine what's next. Well, I can, and I'm not sure if we would believe it. If you were in middle school and they told you that you're going to be able to teleport from one place to another. Now, I can imagine to do that, right? Now, I'm not saying that, but God's got you beat, right? God can make it where a man can be in one place in one moment, and then all of a sudden he be gone somewhere else the next, right? And so human intellect attempts to mimic the power of God. What all these satellites are about really is they want to know what you're doing, right? An all-seeing eye watching you. Look at the monetary system I don't want to get into conspiracy, but look at that little dollar bill and that eyeball looking there, yeah? I think this would be a good time. There was a preacher's joke told, and it's normally used to raise money, and I'm not trying to raise money, so I'll just tell you. $100 bill... and a dollar bill met at the foundry for recycling after spending time in the world and used up their usefulness, and the dollar bill was all crumpled, and the hundred was just being recycled, and they got to talking, the hundred to the dollar, and the dollar said, "Well, where have you been?" He said, "Oh, I've been to Las Vegas, I've been to Niagara Falls, I've been to New York City." And he looked at the dollar and said, "Where have you been?" He said, "Church." Right. Right. Yeah. Anyway, next Sunday. No, I'm just saying. I think about, and I want your mind to go to imagination and invention and creativity. I was talking with Kyle on the trip, and I had an idea for an invention that I think would make $1 million. And what it would be a changeable digital sign that you could stick to the window of your car so that you could tell people in the other car things. And with your words, you could communicate, right? And I'm telling you, it relays ideas, right? Like, move over. This lane is for speeders. Yeah. And the power of words, and I'm talking about creativity, and you think about every invention started in the mind of somebody that imagined to do something, and God said, whatever that they imagine to do, then they're going to find a way to take their mind and put it into action. And you think about from the wheel to the nuclear bomb, humanity has imagined a lot of things. And I think that when we talk about nations and we talk about power, we talk about nuclear power and nuclear bombs because we don't want certain people to have that power. Right? Right? Right. And that's power. But compared to the power of God's word, none of this even scratches the surface of what God can do. Amen. And is doing and will do. Now listen, I think all of us now, at one time, we probably couldn't understand that when Christ returns, everybody will see him, right? We once could not understand that. But now with the invention of the satellite and satellite TV, you can understand how people all over the world will see something at the same time as long as it's not on Netflix. Right? Right. I'm going to hit you where it hurts this morning. These ideas, see, what it is the enemy, the system, wants to mimic God and the creative nature of God and things that they can't do, they want to do, like they want to keep an eye on you. When I worked a secular job and we had these little key cards, and the key cards allowed us to get into the door, right? And then there are companies that take that just a step further. Not only do they let you get in the door, but then they let your bosses know where you are. And at my company, your boss might call and say, "Why have you been sitting on the side of the road for 20 minutes? Right? Don't tell me that they don't know, want to know where you are and what you're doing. They do. Come on. And there's a reason that they do, is because there's a time coming when you won't want to be a part of that system. Right? Now, I'm just telling you the truth. I'm telling you God's word. God's word says that a time is coming on this earth where that you can't even buy or sell unless you are a part of some system. Right. Now, the old-timey preacher, Sister Shelley, said they preached against TVs. They preached against a lot of things, and a lot of them were very right, but they preached against the Social Security number, because in this country, you can't hardly do anything except for voting. Well, no, oh, never. Hold on. You can't hardly do anything without a Social Security number, right? You can't work. You can't get in your tax. You know what I'm talking about. They want to manage the people. You know, David got in trouble one time when he numbered the people. I don't understand it exactly, but it was something that bothered God. There's a few things that are going to happen to this world that bother God. And it's a part of the ultimate plan. But we are in a generation now where we see things more clearly than any generation has ever seen them. Every prophet of the Old Testament desired to see things that we now see. Every prophet that spoke about Christ coming, now we understand the plan of God and what it means for the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. We understand what it means for him to stand before his accusers, innocent, but be found guilty. We understand why that he did that, right? They all didn't. And then now we understand even greater the word and the weight of the word. I couldn't get away from, I was started talking about Jonah a few weeks ago, and I couldn't get away from it. I was thinking about the weight of God's word. God's word came to Jonah, and it was very heavy. You know, words can be very heavy, or they can be very light. You've probably met a lighthearted individual that, you know, they just, they're all bubbly, and they talk, and it's just light and fluffy, kind of like a whipped cream. You know what I mean? And when they talk, it's a joy to be around them for a time. But then after a while, you realize this is just whipped cream. Where's the meat? Where's the beef? Where's the meat? You know what I mean? And there are people that when they talk, you listen to what they say because their words hold great weight. And I remember the benefit of being older is you've seen a lot of things. And sometimes the generation now has not seen the things that you have seen. I've watched as the media in America has attempted to coerce you to believe certain things. And they've been fed marching orders from a machine, right? And there used to be a talk radio show host that would call them out on it. And what he would do, he would look for the buzzwords of the day. And the buzzwords of the day would show up on local media broadcasts and CNN and now every news outlet that's on the TV, you'll hear them say words. The one that showed up just recently was guardrails. Guardrails. Trump has no guardrails to keep him from doing anything that he wants to do. You know, and so all the media outlets were saying, there are no guardrails, and they would repeat it one right after another. And if you played a montage of it, you would hear marching orders from somebody that wants to control what you believe or what you think. Yeah, they want to control the internet so that you can't get an alternate point of view. Right? Because they want to control the narrative. Somebody wants to control what you think and what you believe. Somebody does. God does too. And there's more power in His words than our words. Amen. And so what I heard and what I lived through was an election. I think it was George Bush was running for president, and he was a little milquetoast of a candidate, you know, just a little, you know, I don't know, lackluster, right? And he didn't have a lot of oomph, right? And he was seen as a little weak. And then he added a man named Dick Cheney to his ticket. And the media took up on a word called gravitas. Dick Cheney will add gravitas to this candidacy. And what it meant was the weight of the words that this man would speak. He was very well respected, and when he spoke, people listened. If I were to tell you, tell me when who speaks, people listen. That's exactly right. And that's who to invest in. There was a commercial that said, when E.F. Hutton speaks, people listen. Well, that's because they believed in the value or the weight of his words. And you probably have known people who you respected their opinion, and when they did speak, you valued what they had to say. I remember Levi said, he said, it was kind of a left-handed compliment, but he said... he don't speak much, but when he does speak, you know, it's pretty good. You know, it's like, yeah, I guess I need to speak a little more. I don't know. So the gravity of the words that we share can be life-changing to the people around us. To the positive or to the negative. Because if you'll be honest with me, you know that there are people that you don't want to be around because of the way that they talk. They're a downer. Right? Did you know God's word can be a downer too? Yeah. Right? I had been hooked on Jonah and the thought, and the word of the Lord came to Jonah, and of course he was resisting it, and it became very heavy. Right? And to the point of death. And the calling of God was upon his life. And when they cast him over the overboard, his idea was, I'm going to die. But God's plan and what God said was, no, you're not going to die. And God prepared a fish, and the fish took Jonah. And that word was heavy in Jonah's heart, even for the fish. To the bottom of the mountain, that word sank until Jonah said, yes, I repent, I will go. And the whole time, God's working on Jonah's attitude, right? And of course, we know the rest of the story. The word is then brought and lifted and presented to the Ninevites. And then there's joy in heaven because these sinners had repented. So I want you to think about that word. That word was heavy until that it was embraced, and then it was great. I was thinking about heavy words in the Bible, and a lot of it has to do when we're in the wrong. Now, we don't like to hear that we're in the wrong. We don't like to hear the word no, right? Kids? Mom, can I stay out till 11? No. Right? We don't like to hear that, and we don't like to hear it when God says it either. All right? But when we embrace what God does say, there's great power in that. There's great power for it in all of us. And when our words match His words, there's great power in that also. And I want to tell you something. Your opinion is not necessarily God's word. It may be your understanding of God's word. I said once a while ago, I think Amy may have posted, but don't let someone else's misunderstanding of Scripture be your understanding of Scripture. Why? Because the Holy Spirit's able to reveal to you the purpose and the meaning of the word, and then catch yourself and stop yourself from saying, I don't think God would. You need to know it or you need to shut up. I don't think God would. And insert your issue here. Whatever it is. Page one. The weight of your words, they can be heavy. They can be light. You think of the great novels that have been written to relay what's in someone's mind to the book, or now the great screenwriters that present great dramas on television or in the movies, the details that are whatever they imagine they can express. Well, I don't have to deal with imagination. When you deal with revelation, you don't have to worry about imagination. When you deal with illumination, you don't have to deal with someone else's imagination. When God reveals Himself to you and you experience the saving grace of God, something changes on the inside of you, as drastic as darkness to light, as one that didn't hear and now does hear, as scales fall off of our eyes and we look and we see the power in the Word of God. There's power in the Word of God that will take you from your deepest depth to your highest height. And things that you didn't even realize or things that you didn't even know, God can open your eyes in a moment for clarity and can change your life forever. I talked about nuclear holocaust, and boy, it's a joyous topic to entertain, but you think about all these movies and all these things that are these imaginations often mimic real life. Nuclear holocaust is a real possibility. But you know what? What God's going to do when He peels back the curtain of reality and His presence hits this world, a nuclear holocaust will look like a puff of dust compared to what God can do. I don't know what you know about God, but His word says that the mountains will melt and flow down. They have something called strategic nukes, and even though we strategic nukes is we're going to hit this specific point, right? And I want you to understand, I understand the power that's in a nuclear holocaust or nuclear fallout. I understand all that. I'm not confused at all. What I'm saying is that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because one day the whole earth will be like a sea of glass because of the fervent heat, the heat that is our God. Our God is a consuming fire. And then when he reveals himself in totality, no flesh will glory in his presence because it will be consumed. Every devil will be in hell and every flesh will be like stubble. If you ever want to just get some clarity for biblical sake, read the last chapter of Malachi, which is very good news. Behold, the day will come when the earth burns as an oven. And yea, all that do wickedly will be as stubble under the feet of the righteous. But they, oh, come on now. Yes, yes. But those who have had their eyes opened by the Lord Jesus Christ, they'll go up and they'll grow up in him like calves in a stall, right? How beautiful. And then it talks about the heart of the children being turned to their fathers, the hearts of the fathers being turned to the children before the great and terrible day of the Lord. And so I never planned on saying a lot of this, but I wanted to talk to you about the power of words. And you know it's true. Think of this word and how it changes life. I do. Come on. Oh, Daddy, he's the one. He's the one. Oh, Daddy, he's the one. He's the one. He's the one. Do you? I do. Uh-oh. There's power in that word. If I say, uh-oh, that's three letters? Uh-oh. Oh. No, the H, twice.
Four letters.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Two, yeah, so it's H twice, so that's three letters, right? Yeah. Amen. Amen. Uh-oh. Okay, so, oh, honey, I love you. I love you. Will you marry me? No. Think of the power in yes and no. You know it's true. In the flesh, it's true. And as we transition over into the spirit, it's still true. Turn with me. Oh, I never got to Matthew, did I? Matthew, the 12th chapter, and here it is. And the reason I believe and say what I do say is because of the Word of God. In the 12th chapter and 35th verse, I would like to read to you a couple of scriptures. Jesus speaking, and it says, "A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things. An evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." So which do you choose? Which do you choose? And you know what? Words can hold great value, or they can be as empty as a sounding brass. And what I mean by that is when I say, "I'm sorry." There are multiple different levels of "I'm sorry." I'm sorry with godly sorrow. I'm sorry I got caught. I'm sorry, ha-ha, I'm not sorry. I'm sorry so that you'll shut up. Right? Right. Words, the same word, totally different in results. The same words. When the scripture says, by our words we'll be justified and by our words we'll be condemned, when Jesus knocks on the door of our heart and we say, come in, or you say, nobody's home, we don't want any, right? The response to the word, the weight of words. Turn with me to Proverbs, the 18th chapter, and I would like to share just, we're going to do this a little backwards. We're going to go to the 21st verse, and the Bible says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. If you back up just one verse, Lord, help me. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips he shall be filled. Back up one more verse. A brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city, and their contentions are like the bars of a castle. The power and the weight of words. One last scripture that I would like for you to go to, and we'll close with this, is Luke, the 21st chapter, and the 33rd verse. And Jesus said, heaven and earth are going to pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Right? And I want you to think about something. Have you ever said something that you regretted? Never. Liar. Okay. I want you to think about this in the physical. In the physical. There are words that you say that you can never take back. I can remember being drunk and speaking to my wife in ways that I can never take back. Like darts. They stick. Maybe it was your father or your mother or a friend or a so-called friend. The scripture says that faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of the enemy, they're deceitful. And a lot of people will fluff you up with whipped cream, but there are some people that will cut right to the chase and let you know that there's power in the Word of God. There's power in the Word of God. And so that's why the scripture tells us to be saturated with the Word of God. So that when we speak, it's not us that is speaking, but it's a scripture in context with the Word and the Spirit. And, there are plenty of people that speak the Word out of context and out of spirit. Yep. Just like Peter that drew his sword in the garden to protect Jesus. What a noble cause to protect Jesus from going to the cross. However, that was not God's will. And in fact, it was counterintuitive of what God was trying to do. But Jesus fixed it. He fixed it by healing the ear. And so I say, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Would you stand with me this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Would you bow your heads this morning? Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for the Word of God. Lord, we ask that we feel the gravity of your Word in our life every day, and that our lives would be saturated with your Word in context with your Spirit, that we would be the people that you called us to be. In Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Shake somebody's hand. Let them know that you love them today. God bless you. God bless you is my prayer.